If everybody could take their seats, please. We're going to get started. Thank you, Claudia. So, thank you very much. I know there's going to be a little bit of shuffling as we get started. Just wanted to remind everybody about the fireside panel that's happening this afternoon after the parallel session. I believe it starts at 4:15. That'll be in this room, I believe, but you should check your schedules. So we've got another excellent panel of invited speakers, and along with the culture of the conference, no long intros. The next speaker up is Dean Eckles.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really happy to speak here today. So I'm going to talk about sort of what happens when you have lots of randomized experiments, when randomized experiments are plentiful. And I'm going to focus on some joint work with Alex Pashakovich from Facebook. So the idea is that randomized experiments are the gold standard for causal inference, and often they really help us directly make the decisions that we care about. So if we're comparing alternatives and we can randomly assign units to those alternatives, then we can make the decision between those alternatives pretty easily, and maybe even with heterogeneous treatment effects if you were paying attention this morning. You know, this has become easier and easier where there's lots of tools that make it possible for people to run numerous randomized experiments. We created a platform that's open source called PlanOut, and a lot of the folks here from Facebook continue to work on that open source platform. So it's easy to run lots and lots of experiments. But a single experiment often doesn't answer a lot of the important questions that you might have as a decision maker or as a scientist. And so you might wonder, why did a particular intervention work or not work? What are the mechanisms that are actually important for some whole family of interventions? So maybe we're frequently experimenting with something like a recommendation system, the Facebook news feed. What are the mechanisms that make those interventions work or not work? And then what would happen if we did something else, if we tried some new intervention that's also in the same kind of space? So in some cases, we might have actually designed experiments that allow us to answer these questions. And so in one question we asked is, what are the effects of users on Facebook receiving additional feedback, likes and comments from their peers when they post content? And so we could actually design a larger set of experiments that have multiple conditions that would allow us to identify the effect of this mechanism of various interventions on outcomes like them posting more. So here I'm showing each dot is a single experimental condition. On the x-axis is the feedback that users receive on average in that condition, how many likes and comments they get. And then on the y-axis is how much they're posting. And so here, you know, this is basically a grouped instrumental variables plot. We could infer something about this mechanism. But this required us to design an experiment specifically for this purpose. Google and maybe some other big internet companies run, you know, 100 to 200 experiments on any given day. This is as of 2011. So why should we limit ourselves to either learning from a single experiment at a time or a series of design experiments that were designed for a particular purpose of learning about particular mechanisms? So the idea is that we want to combine the results of many experiments to learn new generalizable knowledge about causal models, about how a series of mechanisms that we might be affecting through lots of different interventions affect the outcomes that we care about. So here's a plot that shows a number of experiments. Each dot in this plot represents one experiment, the mean on one of the mechanisms that we care about, x1, and the mean on another mechanism that we care about, x2. And so the idea is, how could we use these experiments, use this information in combination with outcome data, so their mean on y, to learn about the effects of x1 and x2 on y? And so the framework that we're working in here is this idea that we have these causal variables that are potentially endogenous, the x's, that are affecting the y's. We're interested in learning about the causal effect of the x's on the y's, beta, but it's potentially confounded by these unobserved values u. So that's why we're doing an experiment in the first place, right, is that these endogenous variables, these mechanisms that we're trying to learn about, are potentially confounded with our outcome. And so, you know, omitted variable bias, as we know, makes causal inference quite difficult. And so in one of the examples that's concrete in this setting is we might care about how the number of stories that someone sees in newsfeed from their friends affects how many original posts of content that they produce, where they produce new content, like a photo that they share with friends. We could ask, how does the number of photos that you see from friends affect the number of photos that you choose to share? So the idea is that we're going to use all these experiments that we have lying around as instrumental variables for these mechanisms. And so this is going to be similar for those of you who are familiar with IV analysis. This is going to be similar to a lot of what you see in that literature, but there's going to be some differences as well. So here, we need that that for Z to be an instrumental variable, it has to be as good as randomly assigned, so it's not confounded by you. We've got that because the Z is our assignment to these different experimental conditions. We also need that there's no path from Z to Y, that all of the effects of our experimentation work via some particular set of mechanisms X. And so this is going to get more and more plausible as we make X higher and higher dimensional. Of course, as we make X higher and higher dimensional, we're going to need a lot more experiments, and we're going to need to be exploring a larger part of this high-dimensional space. But that's the general idea here. So, you know, in the standard version of estimation with instrumental variables, we project X onto Z, and then we use only that variation in X that's caused by Z to estimate the regression of Y on X, right? So rather than using all of the potentially confounded variation that exists in X, we're going to use only that variation in X that's induced by our randomization Z. So what's going to be a little bit different in this setting is that we want to do all of this analysis with just summary statistics. So all these experiments have been run over time. No one's, the people who ran them know exactly what these experiments did. But we, as the analysts, may not have that kind of metadata, and we may not want to work with the original raw data of these experiments. So we're going to work simply with summary statistics for each experiment. And so this is sort of how we're visualizing this, is that we have some number of people per experiment. We call that n per. And then n groups, which is the number of experimental conditions that we have. So in the standard asymptotic sequences for instrumental variables, we'd usually have that n per is going to go to infinity. We might have some fixed number of experimental groups, that is, the number of instruments is fixed, but we're going to get more and more data about each of these levels of these instruments. In our setting, that's not exactly what's going to happen, because in our setting, the idea is that we're accumulating more and more experiments potentially over time, but the experiments are all going to be approximately the same size. And so we're hoping that even just by getting more experiments, that we'll still be able to estimate these the parameters of this causal model. So in the case where we think about the raw data, where we have finite n per, but the number of groups is going to infinity, so we're getting more and more experiments, but they're all basically the same size, we'll find that our estimate of beta is going to have a bias that depends on the covariance between this omitted variable and X, and this gamma factor as well. Actually, in the case where we're working with the grouped data, we can actually express this a little bit more concisely. And notice that the bias in our beta really depends on how much of the variation in the group means, how much of the variation in these summary statistics that we have for each experiment is driven by this causal variation induced by our experimentation, and how much of it is driven by this endogenous confounder. And so even as the number of groups goes to infinity, under a standard two-stage least squares analysis of this kind of data, we'll always have bias. So thinking back to this picture, one of the things to note about these experiments here is we have a real like clump of a lot of experiments right around 0, 0. That is, there's a lot of experiments that seem to do almost nothing or do make very small changes, at least in these two dimensions. And so this partially motivates the regularization scheme that we're going to introduce to try to make this causal inference process work a lot better and to eliminate a bunch of this confounding bias from having these noisy estimates. So the idea is, if we really wanted to estimate the effect of x1 and x2 on y, we'd care a lot more about these points that are very far from 0, 0, and are also very far from the principal component line. So we can think of a model of experimentation here where actually we have two types of experiments. And actually, in our working paper on this, we're extending this to a large number of types of experiments, or actually an infinite mixture. But here, let's just think about two types. First, we have sort of null or small tests that effectively don't really do anything to these endogenous mechanisms, whereas we have larger explorations that are really substantial moves in the parameter space. And so the variance of z there is much larger. And so really, if we could use just the experiments that are, in fact, larger explorations of the parameter space, we'd have lower bias. And in fact, if we have an infinite mixture of different variances, for example, if we had a t-distribution that the experiments are drawn from, then we could, in fact, eliminate all of the bias asymptotically as the number of experiments goes to infinity. So sort of inspired by this data generating process and also by what we see in that real picture of a number of experiments, around 300 experiments, we're going to introduce a regularization method. And so here in this regularization method, the idea is simply that we're going to test for each experiment, is it drawn from this null distribution? Is it just a small test that essentially the variation in the summary statistics, the variation in the mean of x, is what you would expect if you just drew a random group of that size without any intervention? Or is it drawn from some alternative? And so these p-values introduce an ordering of the experiments in terms of essentially how likely they are to be drawn from this alternative distribution of real explorations. And we'll just regularize away the small experiments, the experiments that don't really introduce much change. And so you can think of this as us just, given some threshold on these p-values, setting a lot of the means to zero after, of course, we've centered things, or you can set them to the grand mean. This actually turns out to also just be an L0 penalty on the regression in the first stage, the regression predicting x from z from these group indicators. And normally, L0 penalties, where you sort of search over the entire space of possible combinations, are not going to be so tractable. But here, we have all these disjoint groups. So actually, this independence relationship makes it possible to just have this single, simple-to-compute path, regularization path. OK, so I'm going to illustrate this with some simulations where we have 500 experiments, a t-distributed x, where we vary the dimension of x from 2 to 8. And there's a high degree of confounding in these simulations. And so then we can examine the bias and mean squared error of the beta vector. And so here, I'm showing in black this L0 regularization path for this regularization method that we're proposing. And so as we remove more and more experiments, essentially, by setting more and more of these values to 0, by using a smaller and smaller p-value threshold, we are reducing the bias. And so what's interesting about this is that the bias of two-stage least squares in this setting would be 40% of not using any experiment at all. So it really, compared with just doing the observational analysis, it improves things, but it still has a lot of bias. But the regularization allows us to reduce the bias. I'm not going to talk a lot about this, but one of the things we do here is introduce a modification of cross-validation that's designed for this instrumental variable setting that allows us to feasibly select this regularization parameter, because we have this whole path, this whole regularization path. How do we choose what level of regularization to use? Usually you do that via cross-validation, but we want to do that in a way that's particularly targeted to what we care about in this problem of prediction under intervention. So here's these same results showing them for mean squared error. So as we'd expect, when you have regularization, there's a bias variance trade-off, right? But here, the bias variance trade-off is backwards, right? So as we add regularization, that's going to reduce bias, but at the cost of variance. And so we see that, in fact, there is some point where you make that trade-off, and you don't have too much variance added, but you've reduced the bias a lot. And so here, the instrumental variables cross-validation allows for a feasible way to make this trade-off between bias and variance. And so I'm showing here in the dotted blue line how we actually select a model that has relatively low mean squared error using this feasible cross-validation procedure. So just to go back to our example where we have this set of around 300 experiments, these are actually in seven dimensions. I was only showing you two of the dimensions. And so what we're going to do is use that data to try to estimate the causal effect of a number of different exposures in newsfeed, people being exposed to various types of content from their friends and non-friend entities on their content production. And so here we're estimating the effect of being exposed to photos from friends on me posting photos. And so we compute the full regularization path that I just described and select the regularization via IV cross-validation. So on the top panel, we show the estimated mean squared error from this cross-validation. So you can see that there's a point that minimizes this. We select that in the second panel where we're seeing the estimate of this in-kind peer effect. How much does seeing a photo from my friend cause me to post a photo? And we select a particular estimate of that quantity that's different than what we would have selected if we were just using two-stage least squares, which would be the point all the way to the right, but also is not quite as extreme as if we had tried to regularize a lot more and retained only a small number of our experiments. So we're sort of choosing the right number of experiments to use in order to best estimate this parameter of interest. I mentioned a particular regularization method. There's a bunch of others you could use here. You could use an L1 penalty. L0 is nice here because it's actually tractable when it often isn't. Also, you could use explicitly model this distribution of experiments. We looked at this distribution, has some interesting features, some clumpiness, really long and fat tails. And so you could use some kind of random effects model with a Gaussian T or some other non-parametric model, and that's something that we're working on. So thanks a lot for your time.
So if we could get Antoinette, and if there's a clarifying question. So I'll ask one, which is, what's the role of time here in terms of the separation of these experiments in time and the fact that the social system is also sort of a moving target in between these experiments? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I think when you think about the asymptotics that I described, how is the number of experiments going to infinity while the number of people in each experiment isn't increasing? So one way is that over time you're accumulating more experiments. The other is that as potentially the population grows, you're making your experiments smaller because more and more people want to experiment and you're still correctly powered. So I think that's definitely an important issue of like, okay, what should we do with this long-term time? In the example I showed you, we remove all the time trends from this and we're using a relatively short period of time. That was all I won't say exactly how long those 300 experiments are from, but from a pretty short period of time.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, sure.
Can I ask one more clarifying question? How do you think about like the stationarity about the environment? Because if you think, I mean, the last example you gave, say about, you know, do my posting affect, you know, my friends posting and vice versa, but, you know, say if we are in a period of like a world soccer championship versus, you know, kind of a different type of period, right? So these kind of transitions might really matter. How do you deal with this here?
Right, so in this case, we're averaging over that, and the way we might think about it is that we're estimating some sort of average causal response to the generalization of a local average treatment effect, where maybe most of what we're getting at is relatively small changes in exposure leading to relatively small changes in the outcome. But I think it would be really interesting to do a longitudinal meta-analysis where we say, have some of these effects actually substantially changed over time? I think on its own, finding that we have this in-kind peer effect, seeing my friends do something causes me to do that thing, is at this point not that exciting. Like people like Sinan have done a good job of identifying those effects before. But maybe looking at actually that time series, how this effect could change in response to what's going on in aggregate would be great.
Awesome, thank you. Next up is Antoinette Schoar.
Do you have the clicker?
Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me to be here with you. And in fact, it was really nicely set up, because what I want to talk about to you is an example of an application of exactly these type of experiments being run in a particular market, which is in the context of credit cards in financial markets. And to take a step back, what I want to talk to you about is how financial service companies are using these type of experiments on their customers to learn better the type of behavioral biases that people have. Given that I have very little time, I didn't want to go and have to, you know, give you a lecture on what behavioral economics is, but I wanted to give you two examples that probably you have even seen, right? And economists and psychologists like Danny Kahneman, who won the Nobel Prize in economics, right, have done a lot of work on this, but two of the really important ones that you will see also become very important for the credit card industry is, number one, self-control issues, right? And I'm sure many of you have seen the famous marshmallow experiment, where little children are being exposed to sweets, in particular marshmallows, where they're sitting in front of a marshmallow and being told that if you wait for 10 minutes until the experimenter comes back, you get two, or you can eat right now. And there are some kids, right, like this little girl who stares down the marshmallow, but she does a good job not to eat it. And then, you know, there are others like this guy who's really suffering and gives in, right? Now, why do I show you this? Not just to make fun of little children, which is, would be pretty horrible, right? No, it's because actually what is really stunning is that these type of experiments were run on children in the late 70s and 80s, and researchers have followed this and have actually shown that the ability to self-control has more predictive power on the future outcome of these children than even IQ. So from which, you know, a lot of research has now, in a way, ensued to think about what we want to teach our children. A lot of you have probably heard about grit, right, and trying to teach children persistence, self-control, and these type of things. But we know that a lot of people do have self-control problems, and this is not it's not a sign that we are dumb, right? Most of us actually have, in certain circumstances, self-control issues. But if you think about it for financial markets, that's an important bias to know, because if you are somebody who overspends, but otherwise is relatively solvent, right? You might also be somebody who carries big balances on your credit card and therefore is very profitable to a credit card company. So it becomes something profitable to screen for in financial markets. Similarly, another behavioral bias is this one here. If you stare at this, right? Look, these people are going to a fitness studio, but they're taking the elevator. Now why, right? I mean, this is, I'm just giving this as a joke, but you know, this is in a way just to highlight, inattention is another big behavioral bias that has now received a lot of interest and attention in financial research and in psychology. Because it seems that attention is a really limited resource that we have, and where we direct our attention or where we don't direct it affects a lot of choices that we make. And again, this is not necessarily correlated with IQ, right? There might be very smart people. Think of all you sitting here, right? But who are, you know, all very smart, but I'm sure there are many moments in your life where you have so much going on that you don't really pay attention to the decision that you undertake, right? And so you might choose, for example, the wrong credit card or an expensive credit card, even though if you had the time, you would definitely be able to do all the calculations to understand which one is good for you or not, right? So this is the context in which I wanted to show you what you know, financial service companies and what credit card companies actually do, and how do they respond to a world where you might have a lot of customers who have these behavioral biases or have these issues with self-control and inattention. In fact, what I want to show you is that in the credit card industry, when we look at data on the US credit card industry over the last 15 years, the data suggests very strongly that this is what credit card companies screen for and target. So let me show you how we do this, and then we can come back maybe and talk about, you know, what this means going forward for the use of big data to target customer groups. So what we did is, We got data from a company called Compromedia that collects information from between 4,000 and 7,000 people every month who are basically on their payroll, but you know, who are paid for collecting all their financial information and send it, financial mailers and offers that they get in the mail and send it back to the company. This Compromedia company. And what they do is they have been collecting this literally since 2000. And they scan the offer letters into PDF and have it on file. The nice thing is that they actually, what they do, the people that are collecting this information for them are set up in such a way that it actually spans the entirety of the US distribution of characteristics, if you want, right? So we can see, for example, what does, say, a single mother with two children living in Dorchester get compared to, you know, say, a middle-aged father of two, you know, married, living in a, you know, I don't know, in an richer suburb, right? So we can see how credit card companies target these different customer groups and then how they also make them screen themselves. And what we did here, basically this data is all in PDFs, so we built an algorithm, or several of them actually, to extract all the hard information of the card, so say the APR, the late fees, the over limit fees, these type of things. But also just the layout of the marketing, if you want, right? How the card, the offer looks like. So, you know, this is kind of just a stylized credit card offer. I didn't want to pick a particular firm when I show this to you, but this is literally how lots of offers look like. So, you know, you have in really bold print up front the enticing features of the card. So, for example, right here, it's zero APR for 12 months. But, for example, on the first page, it doesn't tell you once the zero APR, which is right, think of it as the interest rate, the APR is the annual percentage rate, once it expires, it doesn't tell you what is the interest rate going forward or the APR going forward, what are the late fees, none of the actually important information is there. On top of it, there's a lot of visual distraction through enticing photos and these type of things. And what we wanted to do, or what we did with our algorithms, is to characterize, right, which offers are more of these, you know, enticing format, and which ones are more plain vanilla, and tell you up front, or in more clear English, you know, what the card features are. But importantly, of course, we also have the ability from this, with this algorithm, to extract all the information on the credit card, you know, on the credit card offer. Why? Because in the US, there's something called Truth in Lending Act, TILA. So while you can, let me say this, and I know this is a little bit controversial, but let's say while you can maybe distract your customers, you cannot fool them, which means that somewhere in the offer letter, the banks are forced to provide all the information of the credit card. Now, this is always on the last page, right? It's always in a piece of paper, I kid you not, that is like so ugly you don't even want to touch it, while the rest of the mailer is beautiful and shiny and looks like this, right? But for us, of course, the good thing is that it means we have this information and we can classify it and then we can do our analysis. And so let me quickly run you through what we are finding. Do I have 5 minutes left? Yeah, six. Okay, so what we're finding is, number one, we see very strong targeting of different customer groups by credit cards. So what we did is, you know, think of it, you know, in the simplest form as, you know, kind of what we used is, you know, hedonic regressions, nonlinear regressions, to just see what type of consumer groups are receiving more straightforward and more forward-loaded credit card offers, and who is receiving more back-loaded and more complex offers. How do we characterize complex? We characterize it by offers that, say, for example, have a zero APR that then increases after 6 months or 12 months, you know, that have different APRs for different type of balances that you carry. And the other thing that we can see, for example, is whether card companies charge you via late fees, via overdraft fees, over limit fees. These are things, I mean, I'm sure all of you have credit cards, but these are things that only come do later, and many people actually ignore when they pick a credit card. So, you know, just quickly, what you see here, these are just the coefficient on the estimates, but what you see here is that basically, I don't know why the X dropped away, but so this is basically from the least educated to the most educated people, and I want you to in particular pay attention to this, because what you see is that basically more educated people, this is after holding constant all other characteristics of the household, right? You see that the most educated people actually have lower late fees than the most educated have lower late fees than the least educated people, right? Similarly, we find actually, and I will use this, you know, kind of going forward, we find that credit card companies use very different reward programs to separate educated versus non-educated. In particular, you know, what you see here is that the least educated are very likely, unlikely to be targeted via mileage programs, while they are very, while they're much more likely to be targeted via this zero APR, right? These low teaser rates and introductory rates. So the first thing that we find when we summarize all this is that less educated people receive card features that are much more backloaded, right? Where the late fees, the over limit fees, all these things are very high, while educated people receive offers that are much more straightforward. The second, this is kind of right, how the mail is sent out. The second thing we look at is how do the banks screen people? Screen in finance means once I hold constant your observable characteristics, there might still be a difference between me and somebody who looks on paper like me. Just because on the unobservables, I might be much less well put together than Sinan, right? And Sinan has his financial life in order. I'm always forgetful, right? And for the credit card company, I might be a great sitting duck because I might not default in the end, right? But I fall late. And what we show here, and I'm sorry, I'm almost out of time, so I'm not going to talk you through the regressions themselves, but you can look at them. I'll put them online. So what we find is that the most educated people are being offered cards that have miles, but that also have very plain vanilla and forward-loaded fee structures, while the less educated people are, in a way, if you want, enticed or are offered cards with teaser rates, but they also get the type of offer structure that is very backloaded. And in a way, if you want, praise or, you know, kind of entices them through the behavioral biases that they might have. And then the final thing, I will just mention it, is that we actually also look at shocks to the creditworthiness of consumers. The way we do this is actually that we can look at different changes in the unemployment insurance. That's a state-level insurance. These are state-level insurance programs. They vary at the state level over the 15 years that we have. And so we can see that in states where unemployment insurance goes up, which means, if you think about it, right, it means that especially less educated and people with lower income become better credit risk, because even when they lose their job, they might still have a cash flow stream from which they can pay the credit card company. And what we find is that those customers, when the unemployment insurance changes, those customers are being offered more backloaded, more complex, and from an advertising perspective, remember I showed you this photo, visually more stimulating, but also in a way more confusing offers are being sent to them, right? So in sum, skip through this, what I wanted to show you is that these type of experiments and the use of very fine-grained data that financial service companies can use on their customers, it allows them to target customers of different types very differently. And of course, you know, from a financial perspective, it makes sense that you're trying to separate the sophisticated from the unsophisticated people and to offer them different products. That has lots of benefits for all of us too, right? Because we're not being offered stuff anymore that we don't want. But it might have a very concerning side effect, which is that in particular people that are not very educated might now actually face a very adversely stacked deck against them. And even in the small type of example of credit cards, by the way, it's not so small because people take a lot of credit in the US, right? It can actually lead to small cognitive mistakes having long-run bad effects on people's credit, but with it on their welfare. All right, thank you.
So if I could ask Dean to come up, and Antoinette can also come and sit. We have about 40 minutes of Q&A, which we reserve to the end. So everybody should be getting their questions ready. And if anybody has a question, we have people with microphones, one in the back there, and another one. There's a question here, and so on. Let me kick it off while we're moving the questions. So, thank you very much, both really interesting presentations. So one thing I don't know about regulation of consumer finance, which I know very little about, is it seems like there are some things that are illegal to screen on. So once we have big data and we have powerful approaches like uses of many experiments in the past where those experiments weren't designed to get at particular things that are illegal to screen on, does it become easier and easier to do that, and how do regulators handle that kind of situation?
I mean, if you want me to respond to this, I think you nailed it, right? This is exactly true that regulators have tried to stay ahead of some of the abuses, and if you think about it, credit card companies or any financial companies are not allowed to, say, screen people by ethnicity or by minority status, by age, by gender. And this whole redlining was, of course, it was a response to this redlining, right, to undo this. But in some sense, I feel we need much more of a discussion of this now that the screening can become more powerful, right? Because I might not have to put in a dummy for black, Hispanic, or white if I can put in a very complicated combination of things that predicts those things. Now, on the racial discrimination, actually, the regulation is actually a step further. So there, actually, you cannot discriminate in a way that even if you say, look, I don't even have information about black, Hispanic, and white, but if the outcome of what you're doing shows that there's statistical, say, difference in approval rates of good cards for different groups, that constitute discrimination too. So they have companies are very careful about this. But you know, things like what is sophistication, right? I glanced a little bit over this because I used as sophistication, right, just education. That is a super crude way, right? Because there might be people who are extremely educated but don't have the time to pay attention, or like my mom, who is a doctor but has no clue what is even inflation, right? So even so on paper, she looks very educated. If she makes financial choices, it's a mess. Like luckily she has me, but that's a whole different story, right? But in the other way around.
Is the same true for you making health decisions?
Exactly.
Okay, so I know we have some questions. Johan?
So I have a question from regulation to regularization to Dean. So we know that at least L1 and L2 regularization have a clean interpretation in terms of priors on outcomes. And with these experiments in these types of settings, it's fairly easy to make things really bad, sort of to break a product or something like that. And I noticed that a bunch of the, I don't know if up was the direction of preferred movement in your X1, X2 plot, but it's
Well, that's partially what we're trying to figure out, whether it was preferred movement or not, right?
Because, okay.
Yeah.
Well, I guess I saw that there was kind of this trade-off where you were often cannibalizing X1 in order to increase X2, or cannibalize X2 in order to increase X1. And it's sort of really hard to move two things up. And I'm wondering if there's some way to encode that kind of trade-off in a prior, or somehow to think about, how do you think about experiments where you suspect that a lot of your experiments are trading off multiple things, and you're trying to figure out how to move both things up? Obviously, you want some like value model over moving everything up, and you get one kind of utility or something like that. But how do you start to think about these experiments moving multiple things and kind of maybe with priors or something else?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting question. And also relates to one of the things I was thinking about during your talk is, to what degree would you be able to actually detect experimentation
right.
in the data that you observe? And that's, to some degree, oddly enough, maybe that's a situation that we're in to some degree, because so we know, you know, which units were assigned to the same treatment, right? So we have these groups of people who are assigned to the same treatment, but we're not always so sure exactly what that treatment was, because that could be encoded in a complex way, and that could be very high dimensional as well. And so part of the challenge here is actually just understanding what is the distribution of experiments that we're drawing from. So when a new experiment is created, what distribution is that being drawn from? And there can be some organizational complexity to that, because different people in the organization are focusing on different goals. And so mm-hmm. they may be really trying to explore one efficient frontier. Another set of people are trying to explore a different part of that parameter space. And so one of the things that we've been exploring is, the model that I presented is basically, there's sort of two versions. One is, there's two types of experiments, ones that don't do anything and ones that do something drawn from a normal. Or there's an infinite number of types of experiments, which are, that is, they're all drawn from the T distribution, which is an infinite mixture over normals. Neither of those seems quite right, especially when you look at that picture and you see that there's clumpiness. It can capture the correlation between them, because we work with a multivariate here, but it may not capture some of the other structure that there is. And so that's one of the reasons we've been exploring using finite mixture models, and also non-parametric models like mixtures of Dirichlet processes. Because I think one of the interesting things is, can we find these kind of clumps of experiments? And there's often experiments that are really particularly pivotal. In the picture I showed, X1 and X2 are pretty correlated. The means of X1 and X2 under experimentation are pretty correlated. But there are some key points where one of them moved up and the other one didn't, or one move at all, and then one of them moves down and the other one doesn't. But maybe part of your point is saying that if you make strong enough linearity assumptions, then maybe it's hard to move beyond your efficient frontier, but you can always move back from the frontier. And if everything was linear, that'd be good enough, but maybe it's not actually linear.
So just to follow up, at Facebook, you must have some information to make some distributional assumptions about where these experiments are being drawn from. You know some information about the organizational context. You probably know some of the people who are running the experiments and so on, right? Mm-hmm. Is that true or not true?
Right, and so you might be able to bring additional metadata to bear on this. And in a lot of cases, you might know that you personally ran some of the experiments that are in some collection, but you might not know about all of them. And especially, I think one of the big trends in, you know, statistics and machine learning as they move into industry is automation and robustness to weird things happening. And so the idea is that this could be a meta-analysis that you do in a, you know, sort of bespoke way, like what we were just showing. But it also could be something that's automated, where as you're creating new experiments, you're just getting better estimates of the effects of all these mechanisms. And so in that case, you don't necessarily want to have to rely on a ton of mm-hmm. qualitative institutional knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Jess?
I want to ask a version of Sinan's question about regulation, which is parallel to like the privacy discussion we had earlier. I mean, in the privacy debate, there's a healthy debate about the cost to like privacy and what people are willing to give up and what they get. It seems to me that the similar thing happens with credit regulation. For example, you know, a lot of talk about what to do about school loans. And if you allow, there's firms who want to do this. One of them called me up, said, hey, we want to give a loan on the SAT score of the school's average. If that were to occur, the loan rate at MIT would be barely above zero.
Absolutely.
Right? So it would just crash, but that has distributional effects. Historically, black colleges, the loan rates would be whatever the US government gives, because they're subsidized.
Absolutely. Right?
So I don't know if like there's a literature of people using the kind of data that you have. I mean, is there a set on like what the efficiency losses are for these regulatory things?
Right, that's a very good point. And you know, this is exactly in finance what you struggle with always, right? Because in some sense, more screening, more targeting means that certain group of the population benefit tremendously, right? And here, in fact, sadly, right, if you were giving examples of screening for credit quality, and there, in some sense, I guess normally we think it feels a little bit fairer to say that somebody who's really good credit quality should pay less, and somebody who has a very, or a pool of people that have a high probability to default also pay a higher interest rate. What I wanted to point out is, we did here is controlling for all these credit quality, you know, differences to show that in this market what can happen is that unsophisticated people are cross-subsidizing sophisticated people, right? And that's a net gain to credit card companies. It's even to the sophisticated people, right? But it comes from the unsophisticated. Now, you're right, though, that we also don't want to over-regulate all these things, right? Because, for example, the other thing that happens, you were saying, you know, kind of rates for black colleges really go up, right? Or they get no credit at all anymore if there is not the government to subsidize it, right? And so the thing that you always worry a lot from a regulatory perspective, are we making credit so expensive that private sector players will just refrain from lending at all to poorer people or to less educated people? And that might be even worse, because then they're going to go to payday loans and loan sharks and things like that, right? So one would want to be really very careful about this. And that's why, you know, I think, you know, we are really at the beginning of this, and it, you know, all of you who really are phenomenally trained, I can tell you the CFPB, so the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, is desperately looking for people of your background to actually, I'm not joking, you're making a face, but, you know, to help with actually data analysis and therefore helping to make much cleverer regulatory choices in changing the regulatory framework. So, you know, kind of to the extent that any one of you is interested in working for government, for the good of all of us, I can only encourage you.
Question for Antoinette, funny one. Given the sophisticated of the audience, any credit card recommendations?
I'm going to refrain from this. Ask me in private. But,
okay. No, but seriously, I got a question for Dean. So one of the things that I've seen as we progressed in experimentation at Microsoft is that more and more experiments are what's called triggered. So somebody makes a small change, let's say, to the weather answer for Bing, and then they assign everybody to the experiment because we don't know what's going to happen, but we really only analyze the triggered users, a small percentage of people that have in their query stream the weather answer. In your analysis, because you're not aware of this, aren't you going to declare all those as nulls? I mean, throw them out because they appear as zeros? Hmm. So in a trigger experiment, typically the trigger rate may be anywhere from 0.1% to 2%, 3%. So any effect that you try to look at when you dilute it to the overall population is going to look like zero.
Yeah, so that's definitely an issue. So in the Facebook context and in our papers on Plan Out, we've referred to this as logging exposure. A lot of these systems have an automated exposure logging, so only once a parameter is checked, like once you see, okay, what value of this parameter does this user have, then you produce automatically a log that exposure occurred, and then you can only analyze the outcomes for those users who were exposed. This dramatically increases power and precision. Now, one of the things you can do, actually, is still use that exposure information to estimate the overall average treatment effect if you know the probability of exposure or if you can estimate that. And so in fact, even if you are just estimating an overall average treatment effect, you can increase precision a lot with that exposure information. And then you would still be able to, when doing this regularization procedure, know that you've estimated that small effect very precisely. And so you would not regularize it away with respect to the null. We didn't address that in too much detail here because this particular application was in the context of newsfeed ranking where the exposure occurs very frequently. So we don't have to worry about that, right? If you're using Facebook, you're generally going to be exposed to newsfeed ranking in some sense. Of course, for two rankings that don't change much, the exposure might not really mean much there. But so in this case, we didn't have to worry a lot about exposure, but certainly to generalize this to experiments in a lot of domains, yes, definitely many experiments only affect a small set of people, and it's very critical to log those exposures so that you can narrow down the hypothesis testing to that population, and so that you can improve your estimation either for that population or for the total population.
So just following up on that, and to sneak in a question about treatment effect heterogeneity so we don't go even one session without talking about it. So when you're looking, when you have a massive population where such a small fraction is triggered or has exposure, how does that affect your estimation of conditional average treatment effects when you're doing this on this small population that's sort of selecting in to the experiment? And I guess the broader question, and I had this running through my mind listening to the first methods section, which was all about treatment effect heterogeneity, is as we use machine learning to search for treatment effect heterogeneity, what's the role of theory, and I mean social and economic theory, not statistical theory, in guiding the generalizations that we make? And is there sort of external validity to some of these? I mean, your presentation was amazing, Ed. And what I thought was really interesting was the very niche conditional average treatment effect that you showed in the school, which was sort of this, you know, in this region of this age in math and science with this type of student, with this size school, you know, classroom, you need a teacher aide to improve the, and so then my question became, you know, does that have external validity, and is cross-validation a substitute for theory in that sense? I don't know if you guys want to address that.
Yeah, I think, or? I mean, external validity is certainly a big issue here, especially as you slice into these smaller populations. So with respect to only some people being exposed to some change, that's great if that's who's going to be exposed in equilibrium or in the long run. But often the people who are exposed early are pushed are a little bit more tilted towards, say, more active users, or in some cases might be some other particular segment. So I think that kind of external validity is a concern. And then I think actually your question about how is this changing over time is an option, is an opportunity to think about external validity. Because if you're analyzing a bunch of historical data, experiments over many months or years, depending on how much you're experimenting, that things can really be changing. And so I wouldn't worry just about, you know, some subgroup, but is something about the broader system changing that means that these effects are changing?
Right. I mean, I agree. I mean, I think your question is really at the heart, I feel, of this debate for social science. That's why, you know, lots of economists are worried about using, say, machine learning just as another more sophisticated way of data snooping, right? We did it very linearly before. Now we can do it even, you know, kind of very non-linearly. But in the end, you know, say, people like Angus Deaton, who won the Nobel Prize last year. By the way, let me say congratulations to Bengt Holmstrom at MIT, who won it this year. But you know, he's very concerned about that. In economics now, people run lots and lots of experiments without theoretical background or framework behind it, and then it becomes a question of what we are learning. I feel there's a real need for theory, but the chance of having all this abundance of data really allows us to become more sophisticated about the models that we are writing. I mean, in the end, there will still be measurement error, right? I mean, it might still be the case that some of the heterogeneity you pick up are proxying for another underlying fundamental that you're not fully understanding. But the more you kind of absorb the space of observables, the closer you come to really, you know, thinking about the mechanisms. And I think that's a fantastic opportunity for all of us in social science.
Yeah, I mean, just to clarify briefly my position on that, I feel like somewhere in the middle is a sweet spot. I mean, the model and the theory itself, we shouldn't have too much hubris to believe that we can write down a model that fully describes the state of the world. And searching and learning from the data is an important way to then sort of theorize going forward. But at the same time, you know, I wonder about this validity issue, I guess. So, Claudia.
So I wanted to pick up on a few themes that also relate to time. I'm very familiar with the credit card problem. I just spent a week writing a paper describing our methodology for targeting people for credit cards and whether or not that violates the Equal Lending Act. I love your feedback on that, by the way. But I think the point is, as we are moving into this with a lot more machinery, machine learning, which tends to be more data hungry, what I feel is happening as the focus of causal investigation is we also tend to focus more on the short-term observable outcomes than the long-term. We're biasing our own investigations on the things we can see. Yeah. And so, for instance, on the credit card, there are many different downstream events and outcomes. You're just looking at who gets it. You don't know who replies, and you don't know who will be accepted if they had applied. Right? So all these kind of further layers that truly capture the impact on society, we kind of tend to... Maybe because of lack of theory, this is a valid answer. Data. So I'm challenging us to kind of keep the time horizon of what we're trying to explain open.
Absolutely. I completely agree with you. So this study is just the first one in a set of studies we're doing. And actually, I am working now with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau to merge this data to user data so that we can actually see who chooses a credit card, how do they then use it, how do they get affected, and so on. But you're totally right that thinking about all the things we do in the longer term and thinking about the things that are not measurable, but that economists like to call the unobservables about a person, right? How do we get at those? And Dean was obviously very cognizant about this when describing, kind of his mechanisms. And I think, you will have the opportunity to track people for a long time and see even things like how do viewing behavior change, over the long run, I assume. Yeah.
Well, yeah, a couple of thoughts about that. One is that it would be not just important from your perspective, but many of the firms should really care about these long run outcomes. And in fact, if they were able to measure the long-term outcomes, they might care more about avoiding some of the perverse things that we see them doing, right? If they had a way of caring about long-term loyalty, that would push them in a direction of making decisions that are perhaps friendlier to consumers or not, hard to say. One of the things I think that's interesting, though, is a lot of times the things that we care the most about, they take a long time to observe, and a lot of other things affect them, and so they're really noisy, right? And so we're used to the idea that in a lot of clinical trials and other epidemiological work, instead of using 10-year mortality, you use hospital readmission instead as one of the outcomes, because you're going to have a lot more power for that. Part of what I think is interesting about doing this meta-analysis work is that we might not have been powered correctly in a single experiment for a lot of those longer-term and noisier outcomes. But by pooling many experiments together, we could still learn something about that. So it's an opportunity for things like survey outcomes that are often noisier and measured on a much smaller fraction of the total population, but also long-term outcomes to make decisions based on those more effectively because you can pool information from many experiments.
So moving along to a similar question around timing, once you think about this notion of you've collected an ensemble of experiments over time, and you say it was a short period of time, which, given the way Facebook experiments, I could imagine, a bunch of experiments being done very quickly. But you could imagine in a world where we sat down and we thought about that more, combining a series of experiments and this concept of sort of adaptive experimentation to take time more as a feature than a bug, so to speak, and to sort of use that to get at the difference between long-term and short-term results, as well as to understand stationarity or non-stationarity in human behavior over time. I don't know if you have either.
Well, and I think that's interesting also from the perspective of understanding organizations and the management processes that are involved. So you might try to mine that series of experiments in part to answer the question, what exactly are we doing as an organization in total? So different teams have strategies, and they may be reporting about those strategies upwards. But you could actually survey over time how is the point that we're in the parameter space and the points that we're exploring in the parameter space, how is that changing over time? What are we learning? And that's part of what I was thinking about with the kind of data that you're looking at is what are these firms learning over time?
Absolutely.
Can you find evidence that they're experimenting in certain ways? Mm-hmm. Are they trying things out that are working or not working?
Right.
So they're reverting some of their decisions. And so organizationally, I think it's a great, that time is a great way of mining that data.
Right. And it's to me, it's a very interesting one because you see, there's also hysteresis within people, right, or that were your subjects, and that might affect how they respond to the next experiment you run on them. So in the credit card context, you know, we can see that they're running experiment because, you know, I didn't have time to show you, but we can literally see that the same person, I mean, I can hold constant, you know, a person and even a bank in my data, right? And I can see that different, so these institutions send different offers to people, even within the same month, that look very different. Now, you know, as the woman in the back said, I cannot right now see what the person takes up, but it clearly looks like the institution, the bank is trying to target them with different offers for them to self-reveal, if you want, their type. Right? Now, the interesting thing, though, when you talk to, you know, I talked to the head of credit at Capital One and Bank of America and so on, and they would, you know, they also say that actually there's a saturation that, you know, so say a new type of product or feature like a teaser rate or, you know, a credit card insurance as a reward program comes onto the market, lots of firms adopt it. And then it seems suddenly it stops working on people. They are not interested in it anymore. And so they, you know, they move to the next and the next. And you know, in a way, they don't really have a model of why people behave. This is kind of what you were saying before, Sinan. But they keep trying until something else hits again, right? And then it seems the industry exploits this. And then you know, they try again. And of course, as a social scientist, I would find it more comfortable if we really had a model of how people's preference structure looks like and why certain things work or don't work on people. But the danger, of course, is then, you know, the targeting, of course, will be more sophisticated too.
I mean, just as a follow-up, how are you guys thinking about the dependence between experiments? Yeah. And there can be all sorts of dependencies, but even the most basic one of, I run experiment two because of what I learned from experiment one. What's the thinking there?
Right, I think that's really interesting to think about, both if you were trying to analyze how do these experiments arise, but also just for this regularization method, you think, what is the distribution that's generating these experiments? Why do I have a clump of experiments that seem to have produced similar effects on the same endogenous variables? Well, probably people were trying a bunch of variations on a theme, perhaps all at once in a factorial design or sequentially. And so you might be able to pick out some of that from talking with people, and that would help to understand the data that's going in there. But it would be nice to actually have a model that does that. And so models like a mixture of Dirichlet processes could give us that kind of clumpiness, but maybe not the dynamic element yet.
Panos.
Yeah, so kind of going back to Sinan's comment about the role of the theory and the model. To be fair, economics has a lot of tools for that, like general equilibrium models, things like that. And more recently, dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models try to learn like how the system responds to treatment. Right now, whether these are successful or not, we don't know. Eurozone was not very successful. DSG said it might be successful, so they didn't turn out to work well. So that's one reason why I'm kind of skeptical towards regulation, like using effect, like estimates of effects for regulation of these large and complex, large-scale systems. Another reason comes from chaos theory, right? Like even if you have the perfect model for your complex system, very slight measurements can kind of give like wildly different predictions. So you might have a perfect model, but just slight mismeasurements are enough to kind of steer you off. So I wonder if you have any comments on that, or how do we, like this sounds like a conundrum, right? Even if you know exactly what the complex model is, still you cannot do correct policy analysis. And
yeah.
One might argue that the financial crisis was kind of, one factor was that, like they tried to regulate banks, say, you know, you should kind of be more risky, kind of give loans to people, but that was interpreted maybe as a signal that that the government is going to back them up, so they become riskier and riskier. And then,
right.
Some point, they say, you know, now we have to bail you out, right? So there was a signaling game there, and it's kind of a tricky, you know.
I mean, Paul Romer made some fairly controversial comments in a paper recently about this as well. So, yeah, right. I don't know if you.
I mean, I feel, you know, you laid out a lot of the difficulties of social science. In fact, I can make you even more depressed. Because, it's true. Whenever we run experiments, our subjects optimize against the experiment. And they optimize against the regulation, right? This is not like biology or chemistry, right? You run the same experiment a billion times, and the stupid cell, right, just does the same thing more or less. But people are not like that. What you're saying is you're totally right. Economists have worried about these things. So, you know, the Lucas critique is, like you said, or Sims, who recently got the Nobel Prize. So people are very concerned about how do we do updating and how do we do regulation in a world where people optimize against and expect certain regulations and where the regulators are part of the system, are influenced by the system and all that. In the end, though, you see, we can throw our hands up and say we do nothing, but that's regulation too, because there's never a nothing, right? If we just say we do nothing, that also means there's a certain type of regulation that then stays or never gets enacted. So I feel, you know, you have to be, as an economist, you have to be basically humble and say so let me also say to what you said about, you know, kind of, it's true, there are lots of dynamic, incentives models about, you know, kind of how people behave or what people call structural estimation, trying to take, you know, kind of very specific, you know, models to the data. The unfortunate truth is that our model, given how complex the social system is, our models are not there yet to really estimate the parameters like a physicist would, right? And so we just have to use a combination of common sense and what we learn from models and data when we make regulation, and to try to be actually as simple and robust rather than being super tricky of targeting, you know, particular subgroups in particular, you know, ambitious ways. That's not a great story to tell, especially not, you know, kind of when indeed, you know, there are pockets of the decision space is becoming so complicated. But I think we just have to be, you know, realistic when thinking about those things.
Yeah, just one comment on that being that in some cases there's more opportunities to find out that you're wrong just because you're monitoring the system a lot better. So if you do hold yourself to making predictions in a lot of these cases, if we were doing this meta-analysis and we say, oh, what if we tried a new intervention that looks like this, where we try to move X1 this way and X2 this way and X4 this way, and then we manage to do that. We manage to move the X's as we expected and some other Y altogether happens. We can sort of monitor that we are wrong in some sense. The other thing I'd say, though, is it'd be great to have a lot more of those kinds of structural models or dynamic models in place to help you make predictions to see how people are going to respond to an intervention over the longer term. Maybe one of the things to do is to try to make those as simple to actually implement in practice and robust in practice. So part of why we found this really simple L0 regularization so appealing is that it's very, very easy to do. Essentially, we always take a whole bunch of means. We set some of them to zero or just drop some of them out of the analysis altogether, and you're good to go, right? This doesn't require some of the heroic efforts I've seen people undertake to do structural estimation in even very simple problems. And so it'd be great, you know, if the, you know, community can help to make some of those tools easier to apply, especially in a kind of black box pipeline sort of way.
Yeah, so I have a question that's actually a follow-up to Panos's question. So traditionally, there's, as far as modes of inferences are concerned, there's like this sort of design-based inference, and then there's model-based inference. And the design-based inference is more robust. You're not making really any assumption, and you're using the randomization itself as a the basis of inference. But as our problems are becoming more complex, the trade-offs between the two, or which one is the most interesting, have changed. It's very difficult to get randomization-based inference on complex network problems that, we're all interested in. And then there seems to be this kind of middle way that both Dean and Susan earlier are taking is model-based inference, but with non-parametric models. So could you elaborate on, do you think that that's perhaps the way of getting a correct compromise between the two?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. It's something like the the tools of randomization inference are really powerful. I mean, sort of being able to wield a permutation test is really great, but then it's sort of you run out of room very quickly there. It can be very difficult to sort of extend it to some arbitrary new case or to incorporate some information that you have that you're not quite sure of, prior information. So we certainly have tried to do randomization inference with networks. So we have a paper that's forthcoming, exact p-values for network interference, in which we do exact randomization-based inference in networks. I think actually Susan talked about that last year here. But in that case, we very quickly run into challenges where without making stronger assumptions, you're going to be really limited in your statistical power. And so I think those sort of assumptions have to play a big role. In the context of the meta-analysis work that we were doing, we have looked at how we might do this through randomization-based inference without making some of the assumptions that we make in the analysis that we presented here. Part of the appeal of not doing that is that the sufficient statistics for our whole procedure are just a bunch of means. And so that makes things a little bit simpler, whereas if we did randomization inference with actual Fisherian permutation tests, we'd need to work with more of the raw data.
But I mean, just to follow up, I think your question is really, very interesting. But it's the more you want to go away from immediate small decisions that people make, right, that are almost like a, kind of cause and effect in the sense like, I expose you something and you respond to it. I feel the more, you go to longer term effects or more complex choices, even the expectations that the person comes into the experiment into is something you need to understand to really make an inference about what your randomization actually tells you, right? Because, again, in economics, a lot of things is about your investment decisions you make, right? Whether in human capital, in anything. And there, for example, you might have, depending on what the subjects were thinking your experiment might be, they might think that you are kind of underexposing them relative to what they thought would happen. And so you might get what looks like a very small effect, but it's because they had built up in advance. I mean, this is just an example. And so this is why I feel understanding very well the context in which you run an experiment, which in the end means having a model, what is going to be picked up in that experiment, is very important.
Well, and I think that actually gets to the question that you asked at the end of my talk, which is that a lot of these effects could be relative to what's going on in the system more broadly at that time. So if right now there's a glut of photos because it's vacation time in Sweden, then the fact that I'm seeing another photo from my friend and how that affects what I do, that relationship could be modified during that time. And so changes in the system could really affect even what might seem like pretty automatic responses. Right. But hopefully the opportunity is that by having lots of data over a longer period of time, lots of clean randomizations, we can find out when we're wrong and notice some of that heterogeneity over time. And when we're wrong, fall back on the design-based inference. And when the model-based inference seems like it's pretty good to rely on that. I mean, some of the things that Alex presented in the earlier session of using observational data, if it turns out that your observational model is pretty good, it's going to be a lot more precise. So maybe you can fall back on that as long as you don't have evidence that it's wrong.
All right. Well, we've come to the end of our time here. So next up is a coffee break. Let's thank the excellent speakers for a great session.